Okay, so this session, I will try to give you a brief overview of health, disease and drug research, because the entire course is about drug transporters. So when we are talking about drugs, you know, we should have some background of drugs. And if we want to have background of drugs, unless we have background of health and disease, it is difficult to understand role of drugs. So that's what we'll try to do very quickly. I'm not going to discuss much because we want to spend more time with Dr. Ambudkar on the main theme of the course. So this is an introductory session. This book will be available here. So those who are interested can actually during the afternoon sessions access from Dr. Uma to this book. This book is Innovative Approaches in Drug Discovery. This is by me with contributions coming from most of the PhD students. So most of the work that you will find in this book is part of our research students' work. Quick present scenario review. We keep on using these terms, health system, healthcare, or medical care. But we use terms health and medicine practically as synonyms in our country, at least. You know. And we mix health and medicine so commonly that, for example, if you go to a website of Ministry of Health and Family Welfare and analyze what they do, you know, at the same time come to Pune Municipal Corporation or any other local government and look at their health department and see what they do, you will realize that majority of their budgets, because budget is the best indication of the activity, you know, majority of their budgets go in treatments, medicines and medical care related activities. So we talk about healthcare, but in reality, our model of healthcare is based on medicine and therapeutics. And this has grown to such an extent because of several reasons. I'm not going to discuss those reasons now. But somehow we are made to believe that by taking medicine, we will get health. And you know, it is not possible because health is something which is very active. You have to participate. Doctors cannot give health. Doctors can treat. Doctors can help you to get rid of diseases. Overall, you will find that the scenario globally is understanding importance of term health. And so you will find that even the National Institutes of Health, where Dr. Ambudkar comes from, there used to be a center for complementary and alternative medicine. It was called as known as NCAM or NCCAM. This medicine term, now last year they have changed the center name and the new name is National Center for Complementary and Integrative Health. So the focus is shifting from medicine to health. And therefore I told you that while we will talk on drug transporters, at the back everywhere you will see glimpses of health coming through traditional knowledge systems like Ayurveda and natural products in our discussions. This is actually indicative of future trends, what are happening. At present, we are actually witnessing what we call it as medicalization of society. You know. The present healthcare is dominated by allopathy or modern medicine or evidence-based medicine. But now people believe that why we should differentiate between modern medicine and other. There is only one medicine and that is evidence-based medicine. You know. It is nothing like allopathy. If Ayurvedic medicine become research medicines, they become part of this evidence-based medicine. So these terminologies confuse us many times. You know. Pharmaceutical companies are defining health as disease management and dictating healthcare strategies. And this is happening not only in India, you know, in many cases. In our book, we have written this, that today the medical education, for example, I'll give you an example in our own state, and this is practically true, Dr. Ambudkar, in all other states. Some 10, 15 years ago, government decided that every state will have universities of health sciences. So every state, in Maharashtra, there is Maharashtra University of Health Sciences. In Karnataka, there is Rajiv Gandhi University of Health. In Andhra Pradesh, there is. So these universities of health sciences, but what do? They offer MBBS course, they offer BAMS course, they offer BHMS course, they offer nursing course, they offer physiotherapy course. This is not health. This is medicine. You know, so this tells you how we go on confusing at the highest level the terms between health and medicine. When this school was established and we gave proposal for health sciences course on the campus, we were asked a question that when Pune has so many medical colleges, why university should invest in medical health sciences school? And we had to tell them that precisely for that reason, because health is not discussed in medical schools. Medical schools' aim is to treat diseases and create therapeutic mechanisms and train people who can manage that, you know. Today's medical practice also has become such that the continuing medical education has become extremely poor in our country. So most of the time you will find that doctor's knowledge is not coming from medical schools, because he has or she has passed out from 20 years ago. At that time, diabetes was not that diabetes what we see today. The therapeutic revolutions have happened in cancer therapy, for example. They are not aware of it, and there is no strong continuing medical education program. Unlike in United States, continuously they have to go on upgrading and appear for different tests for clearing and continuing their licenses. It's not so here. So what happens is, the knowledge which they get is mainly from medical representatives. And medical representatives will tell you what their companies will tell you. And this is how the influence of pharma industry has increased on the sector. I will prefer to call it as medical care, but for common terminology purpose, I'll keep on using healthcare. But when I say healthcare in India, it is actually medical care. Healthcare is typically a Western notion, actually. Healthcare came in existence because they managed basic determinants of health well. Nobody squats on the road there, you know, they get safe drinking water. We don't have that. So without addressing that, we started. And so in West, after giving all those fundamental requirements of health, what remains is primary care. So that they call it as healthcare, which is true. We are using that term or that notion in a wrong context because we are not prepared to use that term. But people need really simple ways to achieve health and prevent diseases, and that's what the basis of Ayurveda has been, you know. Prevention has become the latest fashion in the world now. Top of the top companies, I was surprised, the company like Johnson & Johnson, they are indicating, they are saying that the existing model, curative model, based on treatments and medicines is unsustainable for future. That's what, and so they are trying to come out with new models based on health protection. So they say that, okay, we will make money because that's what company wants to do, but not through these unethical means. We'll have to invent new ethical means so that we protect health and also come out with businesses. So immunity has become one of the major focus now for the pharmaceutical industry, future pharmaceutical industry, I would say. People need healthy diet, healthy lifestyle, and mental peace and relaxation. You know, if you have that, most of the diseases are preventable. So let's see what is health. Health is defined by WHO. So I will not read it out for you, and it is available, most of you know that. But health actually is determined by only four factors. They are called as core determinants of health. And these determinants of health, if any one of them gets compromised, then you lose health. If you lose health, there is fifth determinant of health, which is indirect determinant of health, and that is medical care. These four, genetics, nutrition, lifestyle, and environment, these are the core determinants of health. Out of these four, these two at least, nutrition and lifestyle, are in our control. We can decide whether to go on the right path or wrong path, you know. So if you get bad nutrition or if you adopt bad lifestyle, you are going to invite diseases. And no medicine, medical care is not going to cure that because your basic problem is different, you know. Like diabetes, you cannot cure diabetes by taking medicine. You have to modify your lifestyle if you want to take care of diabetes. Genetics can be prevented. That environment, to some extent, you can, but you can't escape Delhi's pollution, you know. If you are walking on Pune's road, you cannot escape. So, coming to basic determinants, out of these four, one is we can keep aside, you know, prevention is the only thing, but remaining three, we must do something, you know, and we can actually protect our health if we take care of these. But today's healthcare revolves more around medicine, disease, diagnosis and treatments, and not much on prevention and disease prevention or health promotion. Now this I have just drawn, and you will see this, these figures are drawn from our book again, named Integrative Approaches for Health, published by Elsevier. That book copy will also be available for you, for those who want to go through during your course. Look at this. We are in vicious circle today. Patient, diagnostics lab, doctors, drug companies, hospitals, insurance companies, and there is a complex relationship with each other. You will see that. And all this, we call all that as healthcare, but I have put health question mark. It's actually about medical care. And we are today in this phase, you know, curative practice. Our entire effort is about curation and driven by market forces. Therefore, this medicalization of society, and that has affected availability, accessibility and affordability of drugs, despite many challenges still remain unresolved even with advances in medical technologies. So this question we keep on asking, where is health in healthcare? And that we discussed that right from central government or right from WHO also, you can see that the health typical component has remained weak. And in fact, in our book we have argued that WHO definition is one of the reasons why society has become medicalized today. Because one of the principle of management is you can manage those things which you can measure. And in WHO definition, if you see, they talk about state. Now, you don't know what state, you know, how to measure that state. They talk about well-being. Now, you don't know how to measure well-being. So, there is no way to measure state of well-being. On other side, the other part of definition talks about absence of disease, which you can measure. So, the whole focus went on disease, 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 and that's how the WHO definition gave rise to more focus on disease, because earlier part of the definition is obscure. You can't measure what they are talking about. What is wellness? We don't know. We talk about evidence-based medicine, you know, and undoubtedly during last 100 years, the levels of evidence have gone up, definitely. You know, a lot of research is happening and evidence has gone up. At the same time, commercialization also has gone up. While evidence has grown, commercialization also has grown. And unfortunately, while this is happening, the value systems are going down. And I'm going to give you just like one example to support what I'm telling you. You know, why I say that these value systems are going down. There is increased R&D cost, industry-funded research, there are scientific frauds actually reported. There is desperation for profits and there is compromised ethics. Even if you read relatively recent story about Ranbaxy, what happened, you know, when I read that story, I was ashamed, Suresh, you know, what happened in Ranbaxy. And purely it was for this, you know, desperation for profit, that was the only motive. Expensive medical education, fee-for-service culture. Typically, medical profession was not meant for commercial. It was, even today in India, we consider doctors as gods, you know, something, you know, that kind of status we give. But we are in Western adopted model where it is commerce. So we are, especially in India, we are facing this kind of a dilemma. High cost of diagnostic equipments and desperate pharmaceutical industry is responsible for taking these value systems down. In short, today, pharmaceutical industry is under tremendous pressure. tremendous pressure, and maybe some glimpses you will see when Dr. Ambudkar talks about his, you know, but these are, this is a chapter again, this Uma can send you on email as reading material. This title is little different, you know, we are talking about death of drugs and rebirth of healthcare, you know, and this is published by Wiley, and we had to argue with the publisher to maintain this title, you know, because it's a provocative title, and we said that really drugs are dying, you know. Drugs are dying because of several reasons. Pharmaceutical industries also are killing their own drugs for several reasons. Drug fail due to toxicity, untoward effects, you know, and glimpses of that you will get in Dr. Ambudkar's lecture, because this is one of the very important part why drug transporters are important, you know. Starting with thalidomide in 1950 till today, hundreds of drugs have been banned by the regulators or were withdrawn from market, you know. And drugs acting on specific targets can actually trigger a butterfly effect. So this one target mechanism is being questioned now. If you see even simple and common knowledge source like Wikipedia, you know, you will see that this list on Wikipedia actually grows every year. And this list is drugs withdrawn from market after giving approval. Now remember, one drug getting approved from something like US FDA, I'm not talking about Indian FDA, but US FDA, it's an extensive process, you know. Huge data has to be supported, you know. Huge amount of investments go in. Today's estimate is something like 3 billion and 15 years. That's what one drug is. When such investment and such time investment, when drug is withdrawn, what is going to happen to pharmaceutical industry? It's a nightmare for them, you know, withdrawal of drug, but it is happening. These names you may not know, but at least many of you would have heard this Vioxx case, because that was in popular media all the time. Vioxx case, and there are many actually. If you review decade of drug approvals from 2006 to 2015, what happened? You will see that every year, these are numbers of drugs which are withdrawn from market. 40, up to 40 drugs have been withdrawn, this is the approved drugs, and you will see that withdrawn drugs in the next slide. Decade of drug recalls, you will see, well, about 40 drugs on an average were introduced, around 30 to 35 drugs were withdrawn from the market. So this is not very healthy situation, you know, for pharmaceutical industry as well as for consumers. What does it mean is you are getting a drug which is not safe. Clearly, otherwise why they have to withdraw those drugs, you know. And most of the reasons to withdraw these drugs, you will find that majority of the reason goes to about almost 24% of the drug withdrawals are due to hepatic toxicity, followed by cardiovascular toxicity. And again, you will get some of the glimpses when Dr. Ambudkar talks about it. So what is happening all this? Are the days of new chemical entities numbered? Or do we need a fresh approach? Now, these are the questions which people are asking. I will give you one story, and this is a representative story. And this story is about statins. You know that statins, the first statin was introduced something like in 1987. But there is something background going on. In 1984, Time magazine printed a cover story with a picture of eggs. And the title cholesterol, and they painted in the article that cholesterol is villain. Cholesterol is extremely bad and you must control that. After that, American Cardiology Association also changed the norms. What do you mean by normal cholesterol? So overnight, millions of people become hypercholesterolemic. That time nobody knew why this was happening, you know. But this was a red carpet treatment for launching of statins in the market, because they are ready. Pharmaceutical company wanted to put them in the market. Now, one after the other, new analogs of statins came in market. 1987, 91, 97, 2001. It's not that nobody knew about side effects of statins. People were reporting. People were reporting in between also, but they were given no attention. Till such time, it grew to such an extent that first meta-analysis was published in 2010, which undoubtedly showed that there is a link between statin and diabetes. This actually led to one new class of drug in international classification of drug ICD, you know, as statin-induced diabetes. This is in 2012, finally, US FDA and EU both added a warning about diabetes risk to the label of statin. But how many years it took? Look at this. And 2014, same Time magazine. Look at this. Time magazine, Time magazine. What is here? 2014, after 30 years, picture is butter. And the article advises you that you should eat butter. Butter is very good. You know, don't worry about cholesterol. And this is Journal of American Medical Association, JAMA. 2015 Dietary Guidelines Advisory Committee report actually stated that we do not find sufficient evidence to link reduction in cardiovascular risk by reducing cholesterol. Then all these 30 years, what was happening? Of course, those companies are now facing a lot of lawsuits, you know. But why this was happening? The answer is here. Because in this year, 2012, statin patent expired. So that was the end of companies' interest in this product. This is representative story, and many conditions, many drugs actually, you will find that those who are pushed in the market may not have very ethical reasons. But now Uma will take some sessions on network pharmacology. Network pharmacology actually is a tool which can help you to predict toxicity well in advance. So this is, for example, troglitazone, you know, this circuit, she will explain, so I am not going to talk about it, but you can actually predict which diseases are associated with this molecule, what kind of toxicity this molecule is likely to give. So these predictive tools are now available, this refecoxib. You know, if this kind of analysis would have done earlier, Vioxx probably would not have come in market because of the hidden toxicities there. Today we have converted drug discovery into some kind of a pipeline. If you read articles on drug discovery research, you know, they talk about pipeline. Industry talk about pipeline. Our pipelines are drying. That's what the statements they make. Our discovery pipeline is getting dry. Oh, research is not about pipeline, you know. Research should be done for pleasure. It's not a pipeline. So we have converted this into a mechanical process, you know. And that is one reason why we are facing today's problem. The failure rate is extremely high. 10,000 compounds, if you start, if you are lucky, you might get one approved drug after 15 years. This is not 1.5, this is 15 years, you know, and that also about 3 billion. In present model of drug discovery, which is talking about one target and one molecule, but I must tell you that one target and one molecule is magic-like effect, you know. And we should not ignore that. But that kind of a magic bullet was very, very valuable when the world was facing infectious diseases. So we got those kinds of molecules like penicillin, magic molecules. They actually saved us from many disasters. So this, even today, has got tremendous importance. But today, we are facing non-communicable diseases burden more. And non-communicable diseases, it is foolish to expect that we will get some kind of a magic bullet, because we are in a web of causation of disease, you know. It's not one particular reason, there are multiple factors. Metabolic syndrome, you know, diabetes, Alzheimer's, you cannot pinpoint this is the reason. So therefore, we say that you cannot expect disease like diabetes if you forget diet, lifestyle, because obesity, high fat diet, sedentary lifestyle, hypertension, IHD, atherosclerosis, they are all related to each other. And if you forget this web of causation, and if you see that, oh, we have this target can reduce the blood sugar, that is not going to be the therapeutics of future. So, combinatorial and holistic approach is the main strategy today. Multi-targeted drugs, you know. So practically we are facing the end of one target, one disease philosophy in at least the multi or polygenic diseases or syndromes. If you look at the drug molecules picture, you know, there are something like today 2000 plus targets known. Out of that, hardly half of them have been researched. Hardly 350 or so are successful. About same number is in clinical trials. So lot of targets are still unexplored. And so the new tools like network pharmacology can give you some clues to explore these unexplored targets as well. There are about 17,000 drugs. Out of that, about 15,000 are approved. About same number are in clinical trials, and about 14,000-15,000 are in experimental phase. So this is what is the today number. You know, small molecule number universe is very, very large. Out of that, drug is not even a dot. This is National University of Singapore therapeutic target database. You know. So out of those targets which I talked about 2000 plus targets, you will find that most of the targets are enzymes. They're essentially proteins, but most of them are enzyme. Out of these targets, you know, most of the drug research is going on this. But now I was told just in the morning, we listened from Dr. Ambudkar that out of some 200-900 transporters, hardly 9 are coming under the magnifying glass for detailed studies. You know. Drug target, drug specificity is like enzyme substrate, you know, action is like lock and key. But that lock and key can have different conformations when it comes to body system. That we should remember, you know, it's not that one shape. One shape can fit into many other. You may have one conformation for that particular target, but that doesn't mean that's all. In your body, there are other, and therefore the side effects come. Why side effects come? Because targets, for example, if you are having beta blocker, now beta blocker drug, especially designed for beta receptors, that can have also effect on other. So magic bullet actually is not relevant today when we are facing multifactorial etiology diseases, infections, and immunity therefore has become one of the important immunity, and focus is more coming on immunity, improving nutrition and diet, improving environment and lifestyle, and shifting the focus multi-gene, multi-target, multi-ingredients to from one gene, one target, one ingredient. This is what is the shift which we are observing today. We have been discovering medicines for years, you know. And drug discovery, actually, modern drug discovery started in Europe. But if you see which are the drugs emerged initially, the first few drugs, if I want to list, you know, and this we teach for first year pharmacy students, you know. Morphine, quinine, cocaine, colchicine, belladonna, all these are drugs. If you see, all these original sources, morphine came from poppy, quinine came from cinchona, cocaine came from coca tree, tuberculorin from tuberculorae, pilocarpine from jabberandi tree, all these are poisonous sources. And it is very simple that if you go to a forest and if I tell you to come out with some plants which may have medicinal activity, most likely you will come out with a plant which will be poisonous, because it is easy to identify poisonous characteristics. To identify, for example, Shatavari has galactagogue activity, you may need generation to generation study. But to identify something like say pilocarpine, you know, immediately you see that effect immediately. So those poisonous plants, Europe had no great tradition like Ayurveda. So they went on the immediate observational study, so they could explore for bioprospecting most of the drugs from poisonous resources. And this is one of the reasons why initially many drugs which came from poisonous sources. Modern drug discovery has many approaches, you know. Ethnopharmacology approach, which I told you that many drugs came from natural resources route in Europe, that's the beginning. Then it came to serendipity and synthetic dominance. We saw that serendipity and synthetic dominance during the antibiotics era, and many synthetic new chemotherapy drugs came. Then we saw chemical biology. As our understanding of biology grew, the specificity of drug designing also improved. That gave rise to chemical biology approach, and then genomics approach, which we are now experiencing because of the advanced knowledge in genomics, you know. But we follow these three systems in our own research. This is the reverse pharmacology approach, we call it as systems biology approach and personalized approach. Now, personalized approach is coming in mainstream again, and maybe during discussions we will bring this on table again. But reverse pharmacology approach, in short, in general drug research we start from laboratory and end with clinic. But here in case of Ayurveda, for example, people are using drugs in clinic already. So bring those medicines which are actually being used in clinics, consumed by people, prescribed by doctors, and effective, because there may be many which are not effective. Bring them to your laboratory, study them, what is there, why they are active, what is the mechanism. All this is coming under reverse pharmacology, because we go exactly reverse from modern pharmacology, from clinics to laboratory. In India, there are three regulatory routes today. If you want to introduce any drug in market, you know, there are three routes available. First route is through FDA. United States also has FDA. Most of the countries have FDAs or equivalent. Food and Drug Administration, actually, they control entire pharmaceutical market. You know, new drugs also are given license. Under FDA, there are two categories at present. Earlier, we only had one category as new drugs. And the Schedule Y of our Drug Act, you know, will give you almost like what any other regulator will, very stringent norms for introducing new drugs, you know. But now there is a new category from last 2 years called phytopharmaceuticals. So like curcumin, for example, you know, this kind of a drug which is coming from known source, relatively safe, consumed dietary, but single molecule like curcumin, if you want to introduce, there is a shorter, faster route for getting drug approval under the new regulation called phytopharmaceuticals. Then we have Ayush route. You know, Ayush route is classical Ayurvedic drugs which are used, like Trifala, Arogyavardhini. These are classical drugs which are used. And then there are some patent and proprietary medicine under Ayush. For example, what products you see from Himalaya drugs or Zandu, or these are PPP drugs, patent and proprietary formulations. You know, now there is third category, which is under food, but nutraceuticals, because it's a combination of food and pharmaceuticals. It comes under FSSAI, Food Safety Standards Authority of India. You know, this is a relatively new authority, and health supplements and nutraceuticals are governed by them. So this is the regulatory scenario of Ayurveda has helped us in identifying many leads. You know, Ralphia alkaloids came from Ayurvedic knowledge, which became a mainstream drug actually developed by Siba Gaigi that time. So sorlins in vitiligo, holerina in amoebiasis, googlesterone for hyperlipidemia, mucuna for Parkinson's, piperidins for bioavailability enhancers, bacocides in mental retention, picrocytes in hepatic protection, phyllanthus as antivirals, curcumin in inflammation, vidanolides in immunomodulation. This is again a representative list. There are many more. Indigenous drugs actually contribute even today about 63% of new chemical entities approved as of now have some origin with natural products. When I studied biochemistry, you know, in 1982, I passed out. This was Leninger. If you want me to put Leninger on one page, this is what is Leninger that time. We knew about protein, carbohydrate, fat, metabolism, glycolysis, TCA, phosphate monophosphate shunt, and pyruvic acid cycle, and acetyl-CoA, and citric acid cycle, urea cycle, electron transport chain. That's it. Finished biochemistry. That was the knowledge at that time. And the next slide, which I'm going to show you, actually opened my eyes. You know, and after seeing this slide, I asked this question, that after seeing this slide, if I still believe that one target, one drug is going to act, I am living in fool's paradise. This is called Google Map of Human Metabolic Network. And this Leninger is probably fitting somewhere in this dot. This is the explosion of knowledge in biology, what has happened. This is developed by University of California, San Diego. It is called as RECON. The second edition of RECON contains about 7,400 reactions, almost 1,800 genes, and an estimated 20,000 protein coding genes in human genome. So this is a huge network, a metabolic network, we have to consider when we are talking about therapeutics. You know, we are not now in very small understanding of biology. Pharmacology, when I learned pharmacology at Hafkin, you know, this was pharmacology. We were taught receptors and drugs, agonist and antagonist, stimulants and suppressants, and dose response relationship. This is like dose response relationship is like a stone writing, you know. If your drug is not giving dose response, finish, it is not pharmacological drug. That's what was the teaching, and that was true also. But today this is no more true. Pharmacology has become a multidisciplinary subject, you know. Molecular pharmacology has emerged, you know, and cellular and molecular understanding has given new dimension to pharmacology today. So again, in short, one target, one drug, one pill has moved to more targets and poly pill. Today we have, for example, in India, which is this company, Cadila introduced poly pill. You know, they combined 3-4 drugs together, one hypercholesterolemic, one anti-hypertensive, one something, and they just called poly pill. Very good clinical trial they published in Lancet. You know, many times for drug diseases like tuberculosis or even HIV/AIDS, they make these combinations and give, you know. But that is not enough, you know, because the real is multiple target, and therefore we propose that from drug discovery we have to move to formulation discovery, you know, drug discovery to formulation discovery, because one drug will attack one molecule will address maybe one or two targets, but if you combine such molecules together, you know, that formulation can be multi-targeted formulation, and that knowledge exists in Ayurveda, you know, because Ayurveda uses formulations. Now, why they have made those formulations? Presently, we are studying all this from scientific angle. For example, why Trifala? And Uma may share that when she talks about network pharmacology there, you know. So, we are in lifestyle diseases and cluster of diseases today, and therefore, we need synergistic formulation. We may not insist on synergistic formulation for diseases like dengue or malaria, wherein we still may go for one molecule, one target kind of a mechanism. You know. So, multifactorial etiology, infection, immunity, nutrition, life, again I will repeat this. So, this has become very important in today's life. So, we are moving from NCE to intelligent formulation discovery. But that is also not enough, because the next phase is actually new therapeutic discovery. Because all of us are different, you know. All of us are different. When I am talking, everybody of you is thinking differently in mind. All of you, all of us look different, think different. But still, all these years we believe that one drug will have same effect on all of us. But then pharmacogenomics came in, and that changed our understanding, you know. But Ayurveda had this understanding right from the beginning. They classify us in three broad categories, like vata, pitta, kapha. And we hypothesized in 2000 that Ayurveda is personalized medicine, and that article also, Uma, you can share with the group, that Ayurveda is personalized medicine. We published that, and then because our group was working in rheumatoid arthritis, we had a cohort of rheumatoid arthritis patients, and we said that, okay, we'll study. This was in 2002, when even Human Genome Project was not yet fully out, you know. We hypothesized that, and HLA-DRB1 gene and rheumatoid arthritis relationship is fairly known in medicine and biology. So, we selected that gene and we did our study. That was the beginning of a new discipline in India, which is now known as IU genomics. This paper which we published, classification of human population based on HLA gene polymorphism and the concept of Prakriti in Ayurveda, this was published in JSEM in 2004. This was also presented at Cold Spring Harbor Symposium on Pharmacogenomics. Same year, Dr. Kalpana Joshi, who is the active collaborator, she presented it there. And then we did this, expanded this to other genes like CYP. We showed that CYP2C19 gene polymorphism is associated with fast metabolizer and slow metabolizer distribution as per the Ayurvedic concept. We found that those alleles which are known for present mainly in fast metabolizers were predominant in Pitta Prakriti. So, like that we went on then going, and lot of data in this field is there, you know, this is CYP. So, I am not going to discuss more, but today from that original paper from Indian drugs in 2000, we reached here in 2015, paper in scientific reports. This is our group again, genome-wide analysis correlates of Ayurveda Prakruti, in which actually we showed that Pitta Prakruti has predominant gene signature of PGM1, and PGM1 gene, we know that it is responsible for energy production. And as per Ayurvedic fundamentals, Pitta Prakruti and energy are linked. In fact, loose translation of Pitta Prakruti, they do it as fire. If you look at the recent Nobel Prize, you know, visit Nobel Prize website and look at for what purpose it was given, you will see this figure. Now, this figure, if you see, and this figure is from our book, which was published almost 3 years ago, you will find that exactly it matches. So it is not that we are claiming that they copied us, nothing like that. That understanding was with us. But we did not spend time on doing high quality scientific research to present it before the world in their language. And so chronobiology, this is all, and this is our figure, but the copyright of this figure is with Charaka. We learned this from Charaka. You know, this is what happens during the day. The whole understanding exactly matches with this. So surprising. Last part is just 5 minutes, which is directly relevant to what this course is going to be. But I thought that the background which I gave you was important for you to understand and take this course in the right perspective. Drug interactions. Today, if you say take diseases like arthritis, cancer, diabetes, you will find that patients are frustrated. So what they do? They will continue taking, for example, metformin. But they will also go and take Karela juice because somebody has told them that, you know, it helps it. Or they will take some jambul juice or something of that kind. Or arthritis people, you know, they will take cyclophosphamide also, but on the other side, they will take this gugulu. In most of these complex diseases, people are taking multiple, and there is drug-drug interaction, which is the core of what Dr. Ambudkar will talk to you. We have done some studies on this, and remember, these are pharmacodynamic interactions as well as pharmacokinetic interactions, you know. Concurrent use of botanicals in prescription drugs has definitely increased, as I told you. And we have done some work, and Dada Patil is going to come during one of our tutorial sessions, who did PhD with me on herb drug interaction, and he will present our work as well as engage in. This work again is done by one of my PhD student, Amrutesh, who is with Mayo Clinic now. You know. And the earlier work on CIP was done by Yogita, who also did PhD, both of them now married, both of them are working in Mayo Clinic now. So Yogita did in pharmacogenomics and Amrutesh did in pharmaceutics. Amrutesh showed that this Cassia auriculata or Avartaki Ayurvedic plant has effect on metformin pharmacokinetics. So I am going to skip some of these, but these will come back again when Dada Patil will come. So drug transporters, therefore, I must tell you that over this background, now you should look at drug transporters as emerging field in India or Indian research scenario. Membrane transporters are major determinants of pharmacokinetics, safety and efficacy profiles of drug. My knowledge in this is very poor, so I have written only 400, but now it is 900. But out of those 900, which 9 are important, that we will learn during this session. Clinical pharmacokinetic drug-drug interaction studies have suggested that transporters often work together with drug metabolizing enzymes. And therefore, our work on DME drug metabolizing, CYP, is relevant here. Numerous studies have suggested that transporters play a part in vivo in drug deposition, therapeutic efficacy, and adverse drug reaction. So, in present scenario, it is crucial to understand role of drug transporters in ADMET. ADMET is absorption, distribution, yes, tell me, metabolism, excretion and toxicity, correct. So you are going to use this term quite often because this course will revolve around most of the ADMET, you know, and new drug discovery. So last slide, so you will encounter with these terms. pharmacy people may have heard, mainstream science people may not have heard, but pharmacokinetics, pharmacodynamics, BAB, that is bioavailability, bioequivalence studies, drug interactions, ADMET, drug resistance, and drug transporters. With this, I will stop and over to Dr. Ambudkar.
So as we said in the beginning, as also he also said, let's keep this very informal because, you know, there is a vast knowledge about this field, but, you know, providing you everything in 1 week is not going to be easy or possible. Also, the goal is not to overwhelm you with the information, but to provide some key factors or key, you know, points so that you can then explore yourself. And this first talk I sort of developed with the idea that some of you are already using some of this studying transporters in your research, but others may not know what transporters are. So with that, so some of you who are experts, just bear with the, you know, the basic information. And then once we, you know, interact and you tell me what more you would like to know, I think that's what is more important. Because what I gained in the last 30 years, I cannot really tell you, what, none of us can tell you what we can, but what, as Professor Patwardhan said, you know, none of the topics now are with a single discipline like biochemistry or cell biology or microbiology, but it's a multidisciplinary approach. And as you will see, I can give you some of the examples of our own research where we use disciplines from biochemistry to cell biology to molecular biology to structural biology to in silico analysis. So you need, and also pharmacology. So you need to have all those, you know, things in mind. So this is sort of the outline I thought I'll cover. So. What are the basics, you know, the membrane transport proteins, then the types of transporters you'll come to know, and then transporters in ADME. We already, you know, the Professor Patwardhan discussed this. So many, you know, this is very basic. So if you want me to go forward faster, just let me know and I can just skip some of the slides. Otherwise, you know, it might be boring for you people. So many molecules must move back and forth from inside and outside cell because, you know, that's the cell membrane property. And most cannot pass through without the assistance of proteins in the membrane bilayer. Each membrane has specific set of proteins. So not only the plasma membrane, but also the intracellular organelles have the permeability properties. And as you can see, the gases can go through easily from the synthetic lipid bilayer or some of the uncharged polar molecules cannot go really through except for the water or glycerol. So the larger uncharged polar molecules like amino acids, glucose, sugars, nucleotides, they cannot really pass without the transporter. And even though the ions are of small size, because of their charge, they need to be pumped out. You need a carrier or a channel to be pumped out. And this is just, you know, the summary of that. And from the drug discovery point of view, most of the drugs which are given, at least for cancer treatment, are really, they go into the cell just by diffusion because they're hydrophobic or lipid soluble or amphipathic. And that's one of the reasons why the efflux pumps are developed. And the most important thing, actually, what you should take home from is, you know, the energy currency of your cell is ATP, adenosine triphosphate. But almost all the membranes, whether it's a natural membrane from plants, animals, bacteria, or artificial membranes are impermeable to ATP. And that's one of the reasons why the there is a, you know, the ATP is used as an energy currency because you need to have specific transporters to transport ATP. And if some of you, if you are studying the mitochondrial physiology, there is a specific transporter for exchanging ATP to ADP in mitochondrial membrane, because as you know, ATP is synthesized in mitochondria and then it's brought into the cytoplasm. Okay? And transporters are, you know, these are the membrane proteins for moving, again, it's the same thing, into or out of cells, essential nutrients, ions, signaling molecules, cellular waste, environmental toxins, xenobiotics. And in general, the molecules move from a higher to lower concentration. Okay? Doesn't require energy. This is termed the passive transport or facilitated diffusion. Movement against concentration gradient is from low to high, and this is active transport where the cell has to use energy, requires the harnessing of some source, energy source by the carrier protein. And you, as you will see, transporters have very high specificity, or also they have very low specificity, or what we call broad substrate specificity. So this is the difference between the passive and active transport. In your lipid bilayer, by simple diffusion, you can get like the gases go through. But then you have either channels mediating the transported molecule or the carriers where there is a movement from outside to inside. And here the concentration gradient now is going from outside into the cell. And this is the active transport, because you need to have some energy, and we'll see what kind of energy we'll be using. And the passive transport also, although you may have the carrier mediated or channel mediated, but one thing here happens is there is no concentration of the your solutes or ions against the concentration gradient. So these are the classes. Carrier proteins move the solutes across the membrane by binding it to the one side and transporting it to the other side. It's also called alternate access, because your binding site has to face the outside of the cell, where in the plasma you have the nutrients, and then bring it into the cell. So that's the alternate access. And you also have channel proteins. One of the distinction, you'll see that they all have to go through the conformational change. When a ligand binds, it induces conformational change. Channel proteins are small hydrophilic pores that allow solutes, uses diffusion to move across, are also called ion channels when they transport ions. And what's the difference between a channel protein and a carrier protein? So the transporters are also, you know, alternatively I'll use this term, carrier proteins, but that's the same, actually the definition, whether you transport or you act as a carrier to move your ligand. It's turnstile-like, and you know, carriers are like specific, as Professor Patwardhan was telling you about, like enzymes and substrate. But the difference between carrier and channel is it's a very slow turnover. That means it can transport maybe one molecule or up to 50 molecules per second. Whereas the channels can really transport almost to million molecules per second, because you'll see how why it happens that way. It can have a trap door or a gated. Okay. And then the difference between passive and protein-mediated transport. When you have a passive transport, actually it's not at all saturable, because it just keeps going down the concentration gradient till you reach the equilibrium. And that also happens for channels. But the transport proteins, it's a saturable process, which means, you know, after certain concentrations, it reaches the maximum velocity and then it stays there continuous. And this actually is similar to enzymes. As you study enzyme substrate reactions, the substrate is converted to product, but then you saturate. And that's one of the reasons why for studying the kinetics of transport proteins, you can use the same kinetics as you do enzymes with, you know, some modifications, but you can calculate the affinities and other things the same way as you do for enzymes, you can do for the transport proteins. And this is again just repeating about what the carrier proteins are required for almost all small organic molecules. And exceptions are the lipid-soluble molecules, as I told you, which go by simple divisions. Again, the specificity, high specificity or low specificity, but also you have to remember most of, not only plasma membrane, but other organelle membranes also have transport proteins. And as you properly may know, the endoplasmic reticulum also has a number of transporters as well as mitochondria and Golgi. In mitochondria, the outer membrane is more porous, whereas the inner membrane is the barrier. It has to have the transporters. And outer membrane has more channels. So this is again shown by schematics. You know, you have these transporters bringing in nucleotides, sugars, amino acids, or ions being pumped out. In lysosomes, you have proton being, you know, pumped in and you generate. You must have heard lysosomes have a very acidic pH. And one of the reason is that that's then the center for protein degradation. When you degrade proteins, it needs acidic environment. And then you have the ATP synthesis in mitochondria. I just told you the inner membrane has the specific transporters. Outer membrane has more like VDAC channels and others, and plasma membrane. In vacuoles, endosomes also, we have transporters. Chloroplast is another plant things. So the passive transport, as by definition, is where you have only the equilibrium. You go from high concentration to low concentration. And one of the most studied passive transporter is actually the glucose transporter, or GLUT, G-L-U-T protein. And these are, you'll also know about the membrane proteins. They have either single transmembrane helix or multiple transmembrane helix. When the protein has multiple transmembrane helices, they are called polytopic integral membrane proteins. So most carriers, transporters, have either six transmembrane helices going through it or 12. And we'll come to that later. If you have any questions, you can ask me about that. And as I earlier told you about conformations, that you have to have at least two conformations. One when you have the solid binding from outside, and then you know you have the change in conformation so that you move, so that the ligand or this your solid comes inside and then it's released. And this is shown schematically again, concentration gradient. Yes. Yeah.
How many of them are actually insulin dependent? That you are going to take up later?
Yeah, we can talk about it later. So the how it works is the just again re-emphasizing that the glucose is high outside in plasma, and then it comes. So the conformation is open to take the glucose and move into the cytosol, where concentration is low. So when glucose levels are low in blood, glucagon hormone triggers the breakdown of glycogen, because glycogen is stored in liver, which then it breaks down, and then you have the, you know, the increase in glucose levels, and conformation moves glucose out of the cell if very high glucose is in the cell. Glucose moves according to the concentration gradient across the membrane, and also again, now here is the specificity comes in, when it can move only the dextro, the D-glucose, but not the mirror image L-glucose. And for experimental purposes, you will see a lot of people, many researchers use 2-deoxyglucose. That's because the 2-deoxyglucose is converted into 2-deoxyglucose-6-phosphate, but it cannot be converted beyond the 2-deoxyglucose-6-phosphate. That's inert. No, and that's one of the way you can deplete your cells of ATP, because to convert glucose, 2-deoxyglucose to glucose-6-phosphate, you need to hydrolyze ATP by the enzyme hexokinase. You will also see a lot of many papers using 18-fluoroglucose for PET imaging. That's one of the methods used to look at tumors in whole body. This is a non-invasive technique, PET imaging, by which the patient is given a bolus of F18 glucose. And then you can see most tumor cells have very high metabolism of glucose. And you can then see the image of F18. This is the fluoro group, which is actually the detection. And that's how then the radiologist can tell you, you know, the tumors, especially for solid tumors, that you, what level of cancer or what stages are there. And then the active transporters, again, we have the, in this, we have couple transporters where there is a coupling of, you know, two entities, one which goes down the concentration gradient, one goes up the concentration gradient. You have ATP-driven pumps coupled to ATP hydrolysis or light-driven pumps, which are like beta-rhodopsin, which is a specialized thing. Or even in chloroplast, you have light-driven things. And this is just a schematically showing when you have coupled transporters, you have two chemically different entities binding. That's why it's shown two different shapes. And it will become clear as we go through. And then you have the ATP-driven pumps where the energy from ATP hydrolysis is used to transport ions or solutes. And that's like the hallmark of this F0, F1 ATPase in mitochondria, where ATP hydrolysis leads to proton gradient. And you generate the proton motive force. Beta-rhodopsin uses the light energy for pumping out chlorides. And here you have the electrochemical gradient, which is from high to low. So those transporters which are coupled to ions or other gradients are called secondary, because first the active transport, either by ATP or light or electron transport chain, you have to generate ion gradients. And those ion gradients are then used to do the secondary transport. I mean, the transport of, let's say, we'll look at one of the examples, sodium-potassium ATPase. You must have heard of this. This is the most important enzyme in eukaryotic cells, which builds up the gradient where you, outside you have high sodium and inside you have low sodium, whereas outside you, inside you have very high potassium and outside is low. So this gradient then is used from sodium from outside is coupled to bringing glucose. So sodium glucose transport is really dependent on the building of sodium gradient by the sodium potassium ATPase, which is a primary pump. So the sodium gradient is secondary, that's why it's called secondary transporters. So this is the distinction between primary transporters and secondary transporters, okay? And this is again just to emphasize the fact that primary transporters and secondary transporters are linked. As given in this example, I just told you about sodium pump. So in plasma, you know, you must have heard the saline, like 0.9% saline, right? Which equivalents about 150 millimolar sodium, which is in plasma. Whereas your intracellular sodium is 5 millimolar. So that's the gradient. Opposite that is 150 millimolar potassium chloride inside, whereas 5 millimolar outside. And the ATP-driven pumps removes the sodium from the outside, to the outside of the cell from inside, maintain the gradient, and then re-enters with the sodium coupled transporter. That's why we call it linked. And majority of in eukaryotic or animal systems, you use sodium gradient, whereas in bacteria, most of the bacteria use proton gradient. There are some bacteria which also use sodium gradient, which are like in salt water, but those are restricted examples, okay? So this is one of the most studied enzyme, sodium potassium ATPase, requires ATP hydrolysis to maintain the sodium potassium equilibrium. It's also an enzyme because it hydrolyzes ATP to ADP plus phosphate. And you can, you know, study the enzyme kinetics of that, which is sodium dependent, also potassium dependent. And I just explained to you this gradients of sodium and potassium. And this is the schematic of that, where you have high sodium outside, and then, you know, when you bring in three sodiums, like when from the inside you pump out the sodiums, you pump out three sodiums in exchange for two potassiums. So as you can see, there is a charge imbalance, okay? And because of which you form what is called a membrane potential. You will hear this term always, membrane potential, where you have positive outside and in the cytoplasm you have negative. And that's the sodium gradient is then the electrochemical gradient of potassium, which is high inside, low outside, which is reverse for sodium too, from high to low inside. Some of these ATPases have phosphorylated intermediate. That is, one of the amino acid aspartate gets phosphorylated when sodium binds at the expense of ATP hydrolysis. And you have a conformational change such that now once the, unless the sodium binds to the sodium site, you really cannot bind potassium. And so that's why you have this conformational change, which is phosphorylation dependent. And then you, you know, release these two potassium to inside, reforming again, binding the sodium outside. And this is another way of looking at modes of transporters. The solute transporters are the, you know, the you have the uniporter. Uniporter by definition is just a single molecule being transported. Co-transporter or symporter. This is another term being used, where you have two different, like sodium and glucose being pumped out, I mean inside transported, or antiporter or exchange. You use sodium gradient, but you bring out either sugar or amino acid. And one of the most important in eukaryotic system is you must have heard sodium proton exchanger, because that actually maintains the intracellular pH in animal cells. And that's important for the progressive growth of cells, okay? This is mostly, again, re-emphasizing the sodium gradient driven transport, where you have the sodium in outside to be bring. And these are the conformational states which were proposed by physiologists in 60s, but now they have been shown at molecular level what steps take place during these conformations, and maybe we'll look at some of them. And this is the most common, which is about sodium and glucose. So sodium glucose transporters are present only in intestine and kidney to reabsorb the glucose. Sodium-driven symporter is used to move sugars, amino acids, ions. Sodium-driven antiporter, I just told you about the important cells, they used to move sodium into the cell and protons out of the cell, regulates the pH of the cytosol. Similar way, you also must have heard about the calcium pumps. For calcium, which is most important also. So these earlier days used to be called P-type ATPases, like sodium potassium ATPase, calcium ATPase, or you also must have heard about the sodium, the proton ATPase, which is vacuolar, and proton potassium ATPase in stomach, which actually allows to build up the acid in the stomach. That's a proton potassium pump. And these, most of these pumps use the similar mechanism. So calcium is kept low concentration, at low concentrations in the cell by ATP-driven pumps, similar to sodium potassium. Exception, with the exception that it does not, you know, there is no second transport of second solute. It's tightly regulated because, as you know, if you have calcium imbalance, there are multiple effects in the body. Influx of calcium is usually the trigger of cell signaling. And in muscles, sarcoplasmic reticulum, which is the modified ER, has the calcium stores, which is then released depending on the when the, there is a contraction and relaxation of muscle. And so that's why the calcium gradients are finely tuned in muscle. The same way you have proton gradients to drive the movement of molecules across the membranes of plants, fungi, bacteria and all. Then in animal cells you have endosomes, lysosomes. And again, similar to sodium potassium ATPase, but it moves proton. And we just talked about this proton potassium pump in stomach epithelial cells, which, and so that's why you must have heard many people taking the inhibitors of potassium proton pump as the, to prevent the excess acid production. Again, this is, this showing the schematically the sodium potassium ATPase, the sodium driven symport in animal cells, whereas the proton ATPase in the lysosomes and endosomes. In plant cell, you have the proton driven symport, and vacuoles also have the similar transport system, although not shown here. So in addition to carriers or transports, you transport proteins, there are also channel proteins, create hydrophilic opening in which the small water-soluble molecules can pass through it. And if you look at the epithelial lining in intestine and kidney and all, you must have heard the term gap junctions, which means there is a tightness between the each epithelial cell across the side walls, and that's the paracellular transport pathways, which allows the ions to move in and out. But similarly, the outer membrane porins in gram-negative bacteria have similarly the large openings. These are, the ion channels are very specific to regards to pore size, the charge on the molecule to be moved. Mainly you'll see the sodium, potassium chloride and calcium pumps, and then aquaporins are actually the channels for water. They have ion selectivity because of the filters. You'll see the specificity based on the pore size and charges on the inner wall. I'll show you the schematic. Also, it will be detrimental for a cell to keep these channels open all the time. So they are highly regulated. And you'll see that you'll hear the term gated channels, which means they, some of the stimuli like voltage or ligand, the signal transduction will change the, allow the channel to open or close. And that's, the channels are gated, open or closed. Specific stimuli target triggers the change in shape of the opening or the closing of the channel. This is a schematic of the potassium channel. As you can see, this is the membrane with the integral membrane helices, and that's the pore through which the potassium would move through with the positive charge. So in this case, the membrane actually shields the positive charge, the residues, and allows the potassium to go through. And when we have hydrophobic or lipid-soluble drugs, which are mostly used for treating the, which are used as anti-cancer agents, because they are lipid-soluble, even they actually partition into the membrane. And that's one of the distinction between the transport of the positively or negatively charged compounds versus neutral or lipid soluble, and we'll come to that later. And then this is, I just told you about the closed state and then having some signal to open it so that you can allow the movement of ions and then going back to being closed. You have this, we just went through the thing. If you have a passive or leakage channels, they're always open. And these are only maybe specific situations like outer membrane in bacteria or outer membrane of mitochondria, but not the inner membrane. And then chemically or ligand gated channels, which open with binding of a specific neurotransmitter. If you have, that's if you, as an example of the ligand, voltage gated channels open and close in response to change in membrane potential. Or you can also have mechanically gated channels which open and close in response to conformational change of receptors or stress activity. So this is schematic just to show you the what we mean by voltage gated. Change in, if there is a change in voltage, this gate opens and your channel is now active, your ions can go through. If you have a ligand gated channels, your ligand binds to the extracellular sites and then releasing the opening the gate. If you have a intracellular ligand, then it works the opposite way. And that's the stress activated channels, where if you have the mechanical stress, that leads to the opening. And the sodium potassium imbalance, what I told you about by sodium potassium ATPase, actually generates the voltage gate. And that's one of the most important ways the electrical current is passed through your neural systems, in addition to the other things. Active transport can keep ion concentration far from equilibrium in the cell. Channels open and the ions rush in or move because of gradient difference. And this changes the voltage across the membrane. As voltage changes, other ion channels open and other ions rush in. Follows the electrical activity to move across the membrane. So you will see specialized cells have voltage sensors, and they actually regulate these channels. And if there is a defect in voltage sensors, you do have changes in physiology, and you lead to some of the diseases, and we'll get into that later. And this is just the way you develop the membrane potential, which is the distribution of ion gives rise to the membrane potential. So one of the way, the class of the channels is this stress activated, and this is specialized to the auditory hair cells in our ear, where this is the membrane, tectorial membrane. These are the cells with the stereo cilia. And when you have the sound waves hitting this membrane, the mechanical waves, the force actually acts on this bundle, the stereo cilia. If there is no movement, the channels are closed. Once you have the stress, which is transmitted through the tectorial membrane, the channels for positive ions actually open. And then this signal is then transported to the brain, and that's how you get the auditory signal. Okay? In addition to ions, water actually plays an important role in all types of the physiology of all cells. The movement of water from region of low solute concentration or high water to an area of high solute concentration, low water concentration. So you have swelling. And for this, the driving force is the osmotic pressure caused by the difference in water pressure. Okay? And this is just schematically shown. What are the different, you will see a lot of time, many times, physiologists especially using this term, tonicity. Isotonic is where you have equal solute on each side of the membrane. Hypotonic is where you have less solute outside the cell, which results in water coming into the cell and swelling of your cell. Or hypertonic, where more solutes are concentrated outside the cell, so the water rushes out of the cell and you have the shrinkage of the cell. And then again, this is just repeated again, showing the animal cell, the plant cell, and then the protozoan, which have the special vacuole, contractile vessel. So this is, the seawater has almost a salinity of 3.5%, or 35 grams of salts per 1 liter of water. And in person who drinks the undiluted seawater will actually become more dehydrated, and the salt in the intestine may cause diarrhea. And that's one of the salt imbalance problems. And this, could potentially extend your drinking water, the supply through, it can be diluted even with potable water by a factor of 4. You can look at this, website if you want to look at. Normal saline is like 0.9% salt, which is safe for consumption. And the water movement in actually body is by these channels, which are called aquaporins. Earlier, even 50 years ago, physiologists had predicted that there has to be channels for water, but nobody had shown till late 90s that exactly the aquaporins are the water channels. And this is just the schematic with, you know, different locations where we have the epithelial cells and the water channels, even in your eye, intestine, kidney, all over the place. This actually is given in one of the reading your material. You can look at that. I'm not going to read this. So aquaporin structure, actually the history of one of the, so aquaporin, I will tell you. So these, in human genome, there are 12 aquaporin, actually 13. I don't know why, but historically they started labeling as 0 to 12 instead of 1 to 13. And aquaporin 1 was the first one was shown to actually transport water. And, you know, in research we say serendipity, that, you know, unexpected results. So physiologists had spent 50 years trying to identify protein which will function as water channel. And I was working at that time at Johns Hopkins Medical School, and we had my colleague Peter Agre. He was working on an antigen in red blood cells, and he had labeled that CHIP 28 protein. And he had purified the protein, and he had no clue about what the function of that protein is. But it was very abundant, highly expressed in red blood cells. So he came, so I used to do purified protein reconstitution into liposomes, and we'll come to that technique. So we reconstituted in these CHIP 28 into liposomes and showed that it actually functions as a water channel. And then he collaborated with many people and resolved the structure of aquaporin, which is a homotetramer, which means you have four units of the monomers. This is the topology of that channel, and then X-ray structure. So within the span of 7 or 8 years, he collaborated with different people, and in 2003, he won a Nobel Prize for discovery of the water channels. This is just by chance discovery. He was not set out to discover the water channels, but he happened to, you know, collaborate with the right people at the right time. That led to his, now he's working on malaria and trying to, you know, develop the remedies for overcome the malaria. So that's just digression. So we were just talking about the how many transporters, so human 100 known transporters expressed throughout the body. And these are mainly group 2, the solute transporters, which have 300, actually now it's a 386 transporters, 52 families, and the ATP binding cassette transporter, there are 48 transporters with 7 subfamilies. And so these are the some of the main features of the SLC or the solute transporters. These are mostly uptake or influx molecules into the cells. They are located in cell membrane, but also in membranes in the mitochondria, other organelles. And then the naming of the, you know, you'll see different nomenclatures, organic cation, anion transporters, organic cation transporters. But now people are trying to use as the solute transporter family SLC numbers. Except in only one exception is this, in this multi-drug and toxin efflux transporters 1 and 2, which are actually the efflux transporters of this solute. Again, you have the solute symporters, antiporters, or the passive transporters, except for the mate 1 and 2. This is, you don't have to read the whole thing, but this is just a family going from 1 to 52 with different functions. So for each ion or solute or whatever you have, compounds being transported, you have dedicated transport systems. In intestine, you have organic anion transporters, SLC22A family, and there are 5 members, and the substrates, you will come to that again. And then the here, the key feature is that they have broad substrate specificity, polyspecific, mostly also in addition to intestine, also the renal localization and some of the drugs being accumulated in kidney, which become toxic. Again, we're coming to the drug-drug interaction, why we need to pay attention to transporters. This is for the molecular biologists, and you know, when the early 80s, 90s, when people used to clone the genes, that time the X-ray structures were not known. So we used to have this, you will see figures like this, which are the two-dimensional topology model. And again, you have these 12 transmembrane helices, extracellular loops and intracellular loops. And depending on the molecule, the subfamily of transporters, these loop sizes change because many signaling molecules bind to either the intracellular loops, or extracellular loops or intracellular loops. And that's how they modulate these transport proteins. And you'll see many of these transporters have broad substrates of different classes, bile acids, you have the leukotrienes, BQ123, and also some of the statins. Bilirubin also is there. And then some of the inhibitors, quinidine, rifampicin, and these are all used in the clinic. So you have to be, you know, aware of the effects of these drugs on the anion transporters. Cyclosporin A. You will again see these wrap mill cyclosporin A, which are actually interact with ABC transporters. So this is the exception that I was telling you about, multi-drug and toxin exclusion or mate family. Well, there are two or three members. The third member is a mutant of the 2A, which is not shown here. And these are efflux transporters, which are co-transporter with proton and works with organic and cation transporter 1 in liver or 2 in kidney. And metformin is actually the substrate for the mate transporters in addition to acyclovir and cephalexin and some of these inhibitors. This is just, you can see in the thing. So one of the other way to look at the your effect of or a function of a transporter is to make a knockout mice. And we'll come to that in the tutorial in the afternoon, what are the systems used. But this is just to show you an example. When you have a knockout mice which lack the mate one transporter, you can see the difference in the excretion of metformin. And that's how you can also then assign the role to your given transporter, that if you see the changes, that's the role, at least in mice, because mice model is used and which is accepted by the drug regulating agencies like FDA and others. I can, you know, give you this presentation. You can look through the various diseases where these are important. But the bottom line is, you know, they do have a role. When there is a malfunction, you have the disease condition. Some of them are rare diseases. Some of them are have a high incidence. And this is the website where you can get the current information about most of these disease conditions. This is just a summary of the SLC transporters, what are the functional relevance. So you have the glucose carrier, which is most important, which is present in plasma membrane of most animal cells. And this is the passive transport. Whereas the sodium glucose pump, the driven pump, you have the sodium gradient as the energy source. These are functions given. And you can see, you know, variety of these. I just covered all of these, but this is just a summary of slide for your information. And then the next large family is the ATP binding cassette transporters, which have more than 1,100 members. And we'll come to that tomorrow. We'll, you know, go over this family. But to just for today's discussion, you can remember that you have the SLC transporters and the ABC transporters. In eukaryotic systems, mostly these are present on plasma membrane where you have the efflux pumps, whereas in bacteria, they mediate both influx of your solutes or ions or nutrients and efflux of antibiotics, toxins, And now you'll see that there is always, in a given tissue, there's an interplay, interaction between the solute transporters and ABC transporters. So solute transporters, as you can see, this is the liver, two hepatocytes, and this is the canalicular membrane side, which forms the bile, the canal. You have the the secondary or the SLCs, and then you have the ABC, the ABC transporters, which are on this apical membrane or the canalical membrane. And liver is actually one of the organ which is enriched in both solute transporters as well as the ABC transporters, and it has the implications about the liver disease conditions, which will come to that. But for now, you can just remember that there's, you know, most of the SLCs and ABC transporters work together in concert. And one of the examples of that is this hepatocyte in liver, the bile, gallbladder, and intestine. And the primary bile salts like chelate and quinodeoxycholate are synthesized in the liver cells, which are then from cholesterol and then secreted into your bile canaliculi, which goes into the bile, from bile from the gallbladder goes into the intestine, which is actually, it's important in duodenum for absorption of lipids and fat-soluble vitamins. And then the remaining bile salts are then again transported into the hepatocytes. And then you have this cycle going on. If there are changes in the release of the bile sites, salts from the hepatocyte, it also has the effect on all this intestinal function, because it's interlinked. And you'll see there are many cancers where you have the cancer of gallbladder, which has the effect on then all these systems. Okay? And this is just again coming to the final thing with the ADME, where you have the intestine, liver, kidney playing a role. But in addition, the blood-brain barrier has an important role, because this blood-brain barrier actually keeps all the drugs and toxic compounds entering the brain. In addition to other, like the development of modulators for drug transporters to increase chemotherapy efficiency, most of the pharma companies are actually interested in focusing on blood-brain barrier, because you want to get drugs into brain for treating the gliomas and brain disorders like Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, and others. But most of those drugs are actually kept outside brain by this blood-brain barrier, and we'll come to that. Because, interestingly, most of the drugs which are used for Parkinson's disease treatment or Alzheimer's actually are substrates for these pumps, transporters, and they pump out those drugs into the blood, and they prevent. And so there is major focus on learning how to bypass this barrier. And that's why most companies are spending a lot of efforts and money to develop the central nervous system, CNS drugs, by looking at the. So that's actually the overall what I wanted to tell you about as an introduction.